Hello, did you know that in biblical thinking, name equals authority, but name also equals fame? So, by obscuring the name of the Creator, Satan attempts to interfere with the Creator's authority, and Satan attempts to interfere with the Creator's fame. Let me show you. Jews have replaced the name of the Creator with Adonai, and even Hashem, while Christians have replaced the Creator's name with Lord. And how about Pan, Zoti, Her, Uram, Shoda Probu in other languages? Can you see the confusion? Do you see the interference? Therefore, in this video series, we will focus on the original Hebrew name of the Creator, Yod-Heh-Wah-Heh. Numerous topics and arguments will be investigated and tested against authentic Hebrew manuscript evidence. Thanks to Justin, my son, who prepared these topics and who will also be presenting these topics. My name is Pete van Rensburg. Please visit us at HebrewGospels.com.
Hello everyone and welcome back to the series on Nehemiah Gordon and the pronunciation of the Tetragrammaton Yod Heh Wow Heh. This is session number 6. 8 technical linguistic proofs from the Masoretic text itself that the vowels on the name are the vowels of Adonai. And what we will see is that the scribes who copied the Hebrew Bible and wrote these vowels and accents into the Hebrew Bible were very precise and meticulous in what they did. And they indicated for us in 8 different ways. They indicated for us with their pointings whether or not the name is Yehovah. They tell us by their pointings. And this is what we want to discuss in these 2 sessions. Today we'll do part A. We want to talk about the first 3 evidences and also about Nehemiah's B-52 bomber argument. So let's start with the video clip of Nehemiah Gordon and his argument about the B-52 bomber manuscript.
So this is the B-52 bomber of manuscripts, Michael. I've discovered 5 manuscripts that have the same phenomena. It's three prepositions and the word and, where that the Aleph in Adonai is silent, and so the Yud should have no vowel, and it has the vowels Yehovah. This can only belong to the name Yehovah, to the name of the Father. It can't have anything to do with Adonai. And I can't emphasize how important this is, because the opponents to this will say, but the prepositions, what about the prepositions? Oh my God, the prepositions. They show you that these are not the vowels of the name, they're the vowels of Adonai. And here it's the very prepositions that prove definitively that these are the vowels of the name of the Father alone. Boom, drop the mic. I mean, so it's over.
Okay, now I can understand that people watching this, if they don't know Hebrew and they can't test Nehemiah's argument, they'll think that he's right. It looks so convincing. But today I want to ask the question, is this argument a valid argument? Is it over and the name is Yehovah? What is Nehemiah's conclusion here? Nehemiah's conclusion here is that in the B-52 bomber manuscript and other similar manuscripts of the Old Testament, the very prepositions prove definitively that the name is Yehovah. So Nehemiah knows, like all Hebrew scholars know, that this argument of the prepositions attached to the name, when we have these prepositions attached to the name, they can prove definitively whether or not the name is Yehovah. This is not some weak argument or a sideline argument. We're talking about definitive evidence. The only question is, what do the prepositions prove definitively? Do they prove definitively that the name is Yehovah, or do they prove definitively that those vowels belong to Adonai? Now, before we will understand Nehemiah's argument here in the B-52 bomber, we need to understand the argument of the prepositions in the normal Hebrew Bible manuscripts, because this is supposed to be the counter-argument to the argument in the normal Hebrew Bible manuscripts. And today we want to, like I said, talk about the first 3 evidences that will answer the question, Do the vowels shwa, cholom, kames belong to the name or to Adonai? And we're going to look at many photos of Hebrew Bible manuscripts, and I'm going to sum everything up in this table. And you need to understand these three arguments before you will understand the B-52 bomber argument. So, and today it's easy because these seven manuscripts, the seven important manuscripts, all give the same answer. We don't need to divide them into different groups today. They all give the same answer in these three tests that we are going to do. So let's start with proof number one, the phrase Adonai Yodewahei or Yodewahei Adonai. And we've talked about this in previous presentations, but I haven't explained to you what a firm test this is, how clearly this phrase answers the question, are these vowels, Shua Cholom Kametz, the vowels of Adonai, or are they the vowels of the name? So this is a technical argument, and it's a linguistic argument, because in some languages there's no problem in repeating the same word twice in a row. For instance, in the Afrikaans Bible translation, so Afrikaans is my mother tongue, in our Afrikaans Bible, the phrase Adonai Yodewahei is translated as Yere, Yere. In English, that is Lord, Lord. In Hebrew, that would be Adonai, Adonai. There's no problem with that in Afrikaans. But in Hebrew, there's a big problem with this, in pronouncing this phrase as Adonai, Adonai. Because when we have here Adonai Yodewahei, that is a compound name, and it's a title of respect, Master Yodewahei. However, in the Hebrew Bible, whenever a word is repeated twice in a row, it calls for attention. When you're reading the Hebrew Bible and you see a word that's repeated, it calls for your attention. So oftentimes, a word will be repeated twice in an outcry, a call for help, or a call for attention. So, we cannot read this phrase as Adonai, Adonai. That would change this title of respect into a call for attention. We can't do that. Now, here's the argument. If the vowels on the name, that Shua and the Kametz, and oftentimes the Cholam there, if those vowels belong to the name Yehovah, then there's no problem in writing this phrase as Adonai Yehovah. There'd be no problem. It would be Master Yehovah. No problem. And in the reverse phrase, this would be Yehovah Adonai. There would be no problem if these vowels represent the vowels of Yehovah. However, if these vowels, Shua, oftentimes the Cholam and the Kametz, if they represent the vowels of Adonai, then we have a big problem. Because what do we have on the screen? We have Adonai followed by the vowels of Adonai on the name, and this would then be read as Adonai, Adonai. That would be a big problem in Hebrew. We're changing a title of respect into a call for attention. We can't do that in Hebrew. So what would happen if the scribes knew and believed that these vowels, Shua, sometimes Cholam, and Kametz, belong to Adonai? What would they do in this phrase? They would replace the vowels of Adonai with the vowels of Elohim. So this is what they would do. If the normal vowels on the name represent Adonai, they would have to write Adonai and then place Elohim's vowels on the name. That Shua and Chirek and sometimes the Cholam represent Elohim's vowels. Alright? And in the reverse phrase, we will have Elohim's vowels on the name when it is followed by the word Adonai. So can you see the difference in pointing here? If the scribes knew and believed that the name was Yehovah, they would always place the normal vowels on the name next to Adonai, and that won't be a problem. But if the scribes knew and believed that the normal vowels on the name represent Adonai, they needed to replace them next to Adonai, because we can't repeat this word twice in a row. So let's fold this into our big table. If the normal vowels represent Adonai, we'll find Adonai and Elohim's vowels, or Elohim's vowels next to Adonai. But if those vowels represent the name Yehovah, the vowels of the name Yehovah, we'll always find Adonai Yehovah and Yehovah Adonai, and there would be no reason to change it. Now, let's look in the most important Hebrew Bible manuscripts, and these manuscripts are going to answer the question, Are these vowels the vowels of Adonai, or are they the vowels of the name Yehovah? So let's start with the Aleppo Codex. Here we have Lachein Ko Amar Adonai Yodewahei. Therefore, thus says Adonai Yodewahei. Now remember, in the Aleppo Codex, Adonai usually has a missing cholam there. Okay, that cholam is missing. But now look at the vowels on the name. What happened to the normal vowels on the name? What happened to the kamatz that is usually placed underneath that vowel? Now we have a chirek. Remember, usually we don't have a cholam there. Now we have a cholam there. What happened to the normal vowels on the name? They are replaced with the vowels of Elohim. Why would the scribe replace the normal vowels in the name with the vowels of Elohim next to Adonai? Because he knew that the normal vowels on the name represented the vowels of Adonai. They did not represent the vowels of Yehovah. Now, some people look at this and they say, no, this is just tradition. A common phrase in the Hebrew Bible is Yodewahei Elohim, and that is also read by tradition as Adonai Elohim. So this is just traditional to call the Creator Adonai Elohim. So that's the counter argument. But we can test it by looking at the reverse phrase, where we have Yodewahei followed by Adonai. So this is read by tradition as Elohim Adonai. The problem is, this is a very artificial phrase, because if you look at the Hebrew Bible and you look at the consonantal text, there is no such a compound name as Elohim Adonai. There's no such a compound name in the Hebrew Bible based on the consonantal text. This tells us that the scribes ran into a huge problem here. They have this big problem. They can't repeat Adonai's vowels twice in a row. Not at all. They can't write Adonai's vowels and then again Adonai. If these scribes knew that the name was Yehovah, what would they do? They would write Yehovah Adonai, and that wouldn't be a problem. But these scribes, including the scribe of the Aleppo Codex, Aaron ben Asher, he knew that the normal vowels he placed on the name belonged to Adonai, and he could not repeat them next to Adonai. This is very firm evidence from the most respected Hebrew Bible scribe who ever lived, according to most people, Aaron ben Asher. He is telling us here by his pointings that the normal vowels belong to Adonai. Therefore, he can't repeat them next to Adonai. It's not only in the Aleppo Codex. It's also in all the good Hebrew Bible manuscripts of the Old Testament. Let's look at some more examples. In the Leningrad Codex, both in the phrase Adonai Yodewahei, and in the phrase Yodewahei, and then on the next line, Adonai. In both these cases, the scribe changed the normal vowels of the name into the vowels of Elohim. So, what does this tell us about the normal vowels on the name? This tells us that the normal vowels on the name represent Adonai. Therefore, they had to replace them with Elohim's vowels, because you can't read this as Adonai, Adonai. Remember, if the name was Yehovah, there would be no problem in writing Yehovah Adonai. But these scribes tell us that the normal vowels belong to Adonai, not to the name Yehovah. Let's flash through some more manuscripts so you can see all the good Bible manuscripts agree. In the Cairo Codex, in the phrase Adonai Yodewahei, and in the phrase Yodewahei Adonai, the scribe changed the normal vowels, Shua Kamet, into the vowels of Elohim, Shua Chirek. The cholam is usually missing, remember? But they changed the normal vowels. All these manuscripts agree. In the Sassoon Codex, both in the phrase Adonai Yodewahei and in the phrase Yodewahei Adonai, the scribe changed the normal vowels into the vowels of Elohim. Even here in the Damascus Crown, where we usually have the full set of vowels, Shua Cholam Kamatz, which is supposed to represent the vowels of the name Yehovah, next to Adonai, the scribe changed this into the vowels of Yehovah. No, into the vowels of Elohim. If this scribe thought the name was Yehovah, he would repeat Yehovah here next to Adonai. It wouldn't be a problem, Adonai, Yehovah. But no, it's a big problem, because it's the normal vowels represented Adonai. And he couldn't repeat them twice in a row. In this manuscript, we don't have the reverse phrase. And in the 4445 manuscript, the phrase Adonai Yodewahe has been lost, but in all the manuscripts that retain this phrase, in which this phrase is preserved for us, we can see that the normal vowels on the name, according to the scribes themselves, belong to Adonai. Now, even in the Petersburg Codex, remember, they usually don't place vowels on the name. But we know they pronounce the name as Adonai because next to Adonai, they help you with dummy vowels. So here we have Ki ko amar Adonai Yodewahe, and here we have E, O, E, those vowels, the vowels of Elohim on the name. Let's just say they pronounce the name as Yehovah. Then what would happen here? They would say Adonai Yehovah, no problem. But because they usually pronounce the name as Adonai, now we have a problem, we need help. They help you to pronounce this as Adonai Elohim, because you can't pronounce this as Adonai Adonai. Also in the reverse phrase here, Yodewahe Adonai, here it's especially important that they help you with dummy vowels because the name stands first. So it's very easy to read this by mistake as Adonai, and then you see, oh no, the next word is Adonai. So they help you with Elohim's vowels here on the name. So let's fall into our table what we have seen in the manuscripts. All the good Bible manuscripts agree. All these scribes changed the normal vowels on the name into the vowels of Elohim when they wrote it next to the name many times in these manuscripts. All these scribes agree. They tell us by their pointings that the normal vowels represent the vowels of Adonai. Therefore, they cannot repeat them next to Adonai. They have to replace them with Elohim's vowels. Some people think this is the only evidence we have to prove that the vowels Shua, Cholom, Kamet belong to Adonai. It's not. It's one of multiple tests that we can do in the Hebrew Bible. It's one of many evidences that we have. Now we want to look at evidence number two, the inseparable particles, inseparable prepositions, Lamed, Beit, and Kaf. So that is the Lamed, it means to or for or by or even of. Depending on the context, there is the Beit, it means in, with, by, over, among, against, many different meanings. The Kaf there means as, like, according to, it could also mean when. Now, although these are three distinct prepositions with different meanings, they are all pointed in the exact same way. And now what I want to show you is that the scribes pointed these prepositions with different vowels next to Adonai, then they pointed them next to a word that begins with Yehoh, as we would have in Yehovah. And so by looking at the vowel on the preposition, the scribes tell us whether they put the vowels of Yehovah or the vowels of Adonai on the name. So let's look at some of these rules. These prepositions are very specific rules of pointing. And these rules were not invented by modern grammarians. I don't need any modern sources to show you how these rules work, because they're factual, and this is how the scribes pointed the prepositions more than 1,000 years ago. All I need is the Aleppo Codex, and if we have missing pages, the Leningrad Codex. And I've numbered these rules according to how common they are. So even if other people give them different numbers, we'll be looking at the same rules, because the scribes consistently used these rules. So rule number one of these inseparable prepositions is that they are normally pointed with a simple shua. So why do we call them inseparable prepositions? Look at this word in the top line, beshevet. That means with a rod. In English, with a rod would be three words, and the with would be a separate word. In Hebrew, the with, the beit that represents with, is attached inseparably to the next word. As one word, we have the beshevet, and it means with a rod. Okay? But look at the pointing. That is called a simple shua or a shua. It's two vertical dots beneath the line. So all these prepositions are pointed the same way. Beshevet is with a rod. There we have ke'etz, that's like a tree. Here we have le'David. In context, that means of David or by David. It could, of course, in a different context mean to David or for David. But can you see here that although these have different meanings, they have the same pointings? So a simple shua beneath, two dots beneath the line is a simple shua. That's rule number one. Okay, Let's look at rule number two. So the purpose of looking at these rules is to determine how would the scribes point these prepositions next to the name Jehovah, and how did they point them next to the word Adonai. In rule number two, we have an interesting situation, because the Masoretic scribes did not want to write two shwas together at the beginning of a word. So this word here begins with a nun, it's neginot, string instruments. Now you attach the bait preposition to this word. Now you can't repeat two shwas next to each other at the beginning of a word. So it becomes a chirek. That one dot is called a chirek, it's an E. So this is B. B neginot, ki kali, because you can't repeat the shwa twice in a row. Li kalima, to shame. So next to a simple shwa, the vowel on the preposition is one dot, a chirek. Okay, easy. We're getting closer to an answer, because in Yehovah, what is the first vowel? A simple shwa. Okay, now let's look at this. When a word begins with a yod and a simple shwa, what happens? So there I've added the shwa, it's not actually there in the manuscript. Without the bait preposition, it would have the shwa there. And it would be Yeshuateka, your salvation. Yeshuateka, your salvation, begins with ye, a yod and a simple shwa. Now we attach the bait preposition to it. What vowel do we place on the bait preposition? We can't repeat two shwas, so it becomes a chirek. But now something else also happens. We have a contraction. B Yeshuateka becomes B Shuateka. That shwa drops away and the yod forms part of the vowel E, and we have B Shuateka, in your salvation. Okay? And it always works this way next to a yod with a shwa. In the next line we have, without the kaf preposition, it would be yakod, burning. Now we attach the kaf preposition. Can't repeat the shwa twice in a row, so we have one dot there, the chirek. We have ki ye, that contracts to ki kod, ki kod. Now we get to a very important example here, the name Yehoram. Without the lamed preposition, if you delete that lamed preposition, this is what Yehoram looks like. It has a shwa underneath the yud. So we have shwa, cholam, kametz on this name, Yehoram. Just as we would have in Yehovah. So there's a very important example here. What happens when we attach the lamed preposition to a word like Yehoram or Yehovah? We put a dot underneath the lamed, because we can't repeat two shwas at the beginning of a word. So we have li, ye, becomes lihoram. Lihoram. No shwa there, no vowel there. That yod forms part of the vowel e. It's called a chirek yod. Lihoram. The exact same thing would happen with the name Yehovah. It would become Lehovah. Let's look at some more examples. Yehoachazir, starting with a yod there. Yehoachaz becomes Lehoachaz. Yehoshaphat becomes Lehoshaphat. Yehoshua becomes Lehoshua. So this is not just someone's opinion. This is factually how the scribes did it. When you attach these prepositions to a word that begins with ye, a yod with a shwa, it becomes lihoshua, lihoshafat, lihoachaz, lihoram, with one dot, a cherek, underneath the lamed. Let's fold this into our table so we can see if the name is Yehovah. This is what we will find. We'll find lihovah, bihovah, kihovah, as we saw in lihoram. This is how the scribes pointed the lamed, bet, and kaf prepositions next to a word that begins with a yod and a shwa. Now we will see that next to Adonai, the scribes pointed these prepositions with different vowels. So let's look at rule number three, the corresponding vowel. So in the top line, if you begin with a chait there, it's chalotam, there being sick, literally. Now we attach the bet preposition to this word. There's the bait preposition there. What vowel do you place on the bait preposition or any of these three prepositions next to a compound shwa? Remember, that is the shwa. That is a vowel sign next to it. Together, it's called a compound shwa. Now, what you do is very easy. You copy that vowel, not the shwa, but the vowel next to it, over onto the preposition. So that is a chateif patach. Now you copy that patach over onto the bait and you have ba chalotam, when they are sick, or literally in their being sick, when they are sick. The corresponding vowel. It works with all composite shuas. Let's look at some more examples. If you ignore that kaf preposition there, we have asher, with a short other, asher. How do you know what pointing to place on the kaf preposition here next to asher? You copy that vowel over, the vowel part of the composite shua, you copy that over onto the kaf and you have a stripe there, ka asher. Here we have a final example of this. We have the lamed preposition attached to arok, it becomes la arok. That stripe there has been copied over onto the lamed, la arok, to set, talking about setting a table. Okay, now let's look at a similar thing here. Yes, it works the same with all composite shuas. So here we have a chateif segol, a shua, and next to it a segol. What happens when you attach the bait preposition to this word? There is the bait. What vowel do you place on the bait? You copy that vowel over onto the bait and you have ve'emet, in truth. In truth. Here we have ke'ekol, like eating. We'll have to look at the context to get the exact meaning there. But the point is they copy that vowel over onto the preposition. And again, le'ekol, to eat or by eating, that vowel is copied over onto the preposition. Okay, this is rule number three. The corresponding vowel is placed on the preposition when it's attached to a word that begins with a compound shua. Here is an extension of rule number three. Let's look at this. Elohim is usually written with a composite shua underneath the aleph. So if you take off that bait preposition, this is what Elohim would look like. It would have that compound shua there. So what vowel do you place on the bait here? General rule is you copy that segol over and you have be Elohim. Now be Elohim, when you pronounce that quickly, be Elohim becomes be Elohim. It's a contraction. Be Elohim becomes be Elohim. The same with the kaf preposition. Elohim, you would usually copy that vowel over and then you would have ke'e. And that ke'e becomes ke'elohim, like Elohim. And then that vowel would be copied over onto the lamed. You would have le Elohim and becomes le Elohim. So it's the corresponding vowel and then it contracts. Now, let's do something really interesting here. Remember, we've seen in many manuscripts of the Old Testament, sometimes point the name as Yehovah when you pronounce it with those vowels on it. I've made the claim that these vowels on the name Shua Cholam Chirek belong to Elohim. How can I prove to you that these vowels on the name belong to Elohim and they don't belong to the name Yehovah? How can we prove this? We can prove this using the lamed preposition argument. So remember, in Elohim, when you attach the lamed preposition, it becomes le'elohim with two dots there underneath the lamed, two horizontal dots, le'elohim. Okay? Now, how can we do this test? There is one place in the Hebrew Bible where the lamed preposition is attached to the name, where it also is pronounced as Elohim by tradition. And then we can look at the vowel on the preposition to answer the question, are these the vowels of Yehovah or are these the vowels of Elohim? How do we answer the question? Here we have it. It's the lamed preposition on Yod, He, Wow, He, and there's the Chirek, there is the Cholam. So is this Lehovah, the vowels of Yehovah, or are these the vowels of Le'elohim? We can answer the question by looking at the vowel underneath that lamed. So let me show you here. Here we have, at the bottom, we have Le'elohim. The vowel on the preposition next to Le'elohim, on the lamed preposition, is two horizontal dots there, etzere. But on a name that begins with Ye, as we would have in Yehovah, and as we have in Yehoram, usually there's two dots there. Now we attach the lamed preposition and we get one dot underneath the lamed. Lihoram. So look in the top line here. Are these the vowels of Lihovi or are these the vowels of Leilohim? We have two dots underneath the lamed, just as we have two dots underneath the lamed of Leilohim. We don't have one dot there as we would have in Lihoram or in Lihova. Now this is just one dot, but this is how precise the scribes were. This is like, remember who wrote the Aleppo Codex? Aaron ben Asher, sorry, who pointed it? This is his signature saying, I'm telling you, these vowels belong to Elohim, they don't belong to the name Yehovah. It's as good, from a linguistic perspective, if you understand how these prepositions work, it's as good as him writing a note in the margin and saying, Shua Cholom Chirek are the vowels of Elohim, they're not the vowels of Yehovah. It's almost as good as that, just because we can look at the pointings he placed on the Lamed preposition. Now, just like this proves beyond any shadow of a doubt that these vowels, Yehovah, do not belong to the name but belong to Elohim, so we can do the same test with the normal vowels on the name. We can do the same test with the vowels Shua Cholom Kamet using the Lamed preposition argument. So clearly here we have the vowels of Leilohim on the name. So how would the Lamed, Beit, and Kaf prepositions, how are they pointed next to Adonai? Let's look at some examples here. Without the Beit preposition, this is Adonai with the Chatev Patach there. How do you know what vowel to place on the preposition? You copy that stripe over and you place it on the preposition. And now you have Ba Adonai. Now just like in Le Elohim it becomes Le Elohim, so Ba Adonai becomes Badonai. And that vowel is dropped. So this is what we have in the manuscripts, Badonai. And there's no vowel left there, but we still have the corresponding vowel here. This is still the corresponding vowel of what used to be underneath the Aleph. So that is Badonai with a stripe underneath the Beit. In the next line, this used to be without the Kaf, it's Adonau. Adonau means his Lord, but it's pointed in the same way as Adonai. So you can just ignore the vowel there, and we have the pointings and the word Adonai. So you copy that stripe over onto the Kaf, and you have Ka'ai and becomes Kadonai. In this case, Kadonau. Last example, Adonai, that vowel is copied over onto the Lamed and it becomes Ladonai. So here we have the answer. How would these prepositions, how are they pointed next to Adonai? With a stripe underneath the preposition called a patach. So let's fold this into our table. Ladonai, Badonai, and Kadonai. Now we can go and look at the Hebrew Bible manuscripts and look at the vowel on the preposition, and just like that vowel told us in Psalm 68 that the name is not Yehovah, but those are the vowels of Elohim, so the vowels here on the preposition are going to tell us whether the name is Yehovah or not. Because in Yehovah, as we would have in Lihoram, we have here Lihovah as we'd have in Lihoram, here we have a Chirek. If the name is Yehovah, we'll find one dot underneath the preposition. If they put the vowels of Adonai on the name, we'll find a stripe underneath the preposition. So are you ready? We'll start with the Aleppo Codex. What vowels are placed on the name? Look at the vowel on the preposition. It's a stripe. Ba yodeh wahei. So are these the vowels of Bihova or the vowels of Badonai? Remember look at Badonai here. There's a stripe underneath the Beit. These are the vowels of Badonai that are placed on the name. Here we have the Kaf preposition attached to Yodeh Wahei. What vowel do we find on the Kaf preposition? We find a stripe as we have in Kadonai or in Kadonau. Here we have the Lamed preposition on Yodeh Wahei. What vowel do we see here? A stripe as in Ladonai, not a Cherek as we would have in Lihova. This is clear evidence from the Aleppo Codex, telling us that these are the vowels of Adonai. How do we know this? Because in the Aleppo Codex, when we have a name like Yehoshaphat, it becomes Lihoshaphat, not Lahoshaphat. We have Yehoshua, it becomes Lihoshua with a dot there, not Lahoshua. And we have Jehoram, as we would have in Jehovah, becomes Lehoram. This is how Aaron ben Asher pointed names that begin with Yeh. So he's telling us by his pointings here, Aaron ben Asher is telling us here that the vowels on the name belong to Adonai. They don't belong to the name Jehovah. They belong to Adonai, because he placed the stripe underneath this bait, as in Badonai, underneath the kaf, underneath the lamed, not the cherek. It's not only in the Aleppo Codex, it's in all good Hebrew Bible manuscripts. The name, when you attach the lamed preposition to the name and these other prepositions, this is the vowel pointing that we find. Let's look at some examples. The Leningrad Codex place a stripe underneath these prepositions, not a dot. So these are the vowels of Adonai, not the vowels of Jehovah. Otherwise we would have a dot there. In the 445 manuscript, there is a stripe underneath the Beit, Kaf, and Lamed prepositions when attached to the name. So they place the vowels of Badonai, Kadonai, Ladonai, and so on the name, not the vowels of Jehovah. In the Cairo Codex of the Prophets, they place a stripe underneath these prepositions. The vowels of Adonai are placed on the name, not the vowels of Jehovah. In the Sassoon 507 manuscript, known as the Damascus Crown or the Damascus Pentateuch, they place a stripe underneath the Beit, Kaf, and Lamed prepositions next to the name. So these are the vowels of Badonai, Kadonai, Ladonai, not the vowels of Biova, Kiova, Liova. All these manuscripts agree, even in the Sassoon Codex, there's a stripe underneath the Beit, underneath the Kaf. So that is the top of a Lamed that stands on the next line. That is the Patach. It's a stripe there. Here you can clearly see the stripe. All these manuscripts agree. They all give the same answer. They tell us by their vowel points that the vowels on the name belong to Adonai, not to the name itself. Even here in the Petersburg Codex, where we don't normally have vowels on the name, these prepositions tell us that they pronounce the name as Adonai. Here's an example where you can see Ladonai. Now here, interestingly, the short A is still written there, so perhaps they said La Adonai. In any way, the vowel on the preposition tells us La Yodewahe. That means they said Ladonai. Here's Va or Ba Yodewahe. They said Badonai, not Behova. The vowel on the preposition clearly answers the question. And all the good Hebrew Bible manuscripts agree. They all tell us that the vowels of Ladonai are placed on the name. Badonai, Kadonai, not the vowels of Lehovah. Okay, we're almost done. Just one more evidence and we'll be ready for the B-52 bomber argument. Now the next evidence that we want to talk about is the vowel conjunction. So it is often pointed in the same way as the prepositions, but not always. And it's also not really a preposition. So I take this as a separate evidence, a separate test that we can do. Now we need to work through some more rules here. So rule number one for the vowel conjunction is that it's also pointed with a simple shua normally. Two dots beneath the line, two vertical dots there. So at the top we have wach, chataim, and sinners, wederek, and away, and a road, so on, werosnim, and rulers. So usually it is pointed with a simple shua. Next to a simple shua, where the lamed, beit, and kaf prepositions are pointed with a cherek, the waw is pointed with a dot in the middle, and now it's called a shurek. It's an oo sound. So we have oo lesaper. Remember, why do they do this change? Because they can't repeat two shuas. They couldn't write another shua there next to that shua. So it becomes oo lesaper, and to count. Oo de oo, and no, masculine plural imperative. And also next to a labial, like a maim, a bait, or a pay, it's also pointed as a shurek. So here we have oo meirim, and he or and the one who lifts up. So this is rule number two, a shurek next to a simple shua or a labial. Okay, here is rule number four. It's quite rare, but whenever this vowel conjunction is attached to a word that begins with a yod and a simple shua, It's not point as u, it's point as we, with a dot there, a chirek. So this used to be Yehoram, with a schwa there. Now it is Wehoram, and that schwa is again dropped. So it's not u Yehoram, nor is it we Yehoram, it's just Wehoram. Yehoshaphat becomes Wehoshaphat. Yehoshua becomes Wehoshua. So if the name is Yehovah, as we would have in Yehoram at the top there, what would the pointing on the waw conjunction be next to Yehovah? It would be a chirek, one dot. Let's fold this into our table. If the name is Yehovah, we will find Wehovah with one dot underneath that waw conjunction, just as in Wehoram. Okay, how would this be pointed next to Adonai? The waw conjunction next to a compound schwa also takes the corresponding vowel. So this is wa'ani, and I. The vowel on the waw is copied from the vowel on the aleph. That vowel is copied over. Here we have we'emet, and truth. That vowel is copied over onto the waw. Here we have wa'adonenu, and our Lord. That vowel is copied over onto the waw. So next to Adonai, what would happen? Here we can see next to Adonai what happens. The Adonai is usually written this way. Adonai. You copy that vowel over and you have wa'adonai, and it just contracts to wa'adonai. And Elohim would be we'elohim, it just becomes we'elohim. Okay, so next to Adonai we will find a stripe underneath the waw conjunction. So interestingly, next to Adonai and next to a name like Yehoram or Yehoshua, this waw conjunction is pointed with the same vowel points as the other three prepositions, but is not always pointed in the same way. Now we are ready to look at the manuscripts. What vowels did the scribes put on the name? The vowels of Adonai with a stripe on the waw, or the vowels of Wehovah with a chirek, a dot, underneath the waw? Let's see. Here we have the Aleppo Codex. Three examples here. We have the waw conjunction attached to the name, and we have the patach, a stripe underneath it. These are the vowels of Adonai. The vowels of Adonai. The vowels of Adonai are placed on the name, not the vowels of Wehovah. Remember, this is more than just a theory, because we can see in the Aleppo Codex, when the waw conjunction is attached to a name that begins with Yeho, it becomes Weho. Yehoram becomes Wehoram. Yehoshaphat becomes Wehoshaphat. Yehoshua becomes Wehoshua. So if the name is Yehovah, we will see in the manuscripts Wehovah. But we don't. We don't see this in the manuscripts. Let's look at some more examples. The Leningrad Codex places a stripe underneath the waw. The Cairo Codex has a stripe underneath the waw. The 445 manuscript has a stripe underneath the waw, not a dot. The scribes are telling us by their pointings, they're indicating for us that these vowels belong to Adonai, not to Wehovah. The Sassoon Codex also has a stripe underneath the waw. The Sassoon 507 here is the Damascus crown. It also has a stripe underneath the waw. All the manuscripts agree. There's no disagreement here. All the manuscripts give the same answer. The vowels of Adonai were placed on the name. And even here in the Petersburg Codex, although there are no vowels here on the name, we still have an R on the waw conjunction. Wa, Donai. All the manuscripts give the same answer. Let's fold this into our table. We have the vowels of Wa, Donai are placed on the name, as you can see it here. Wa, Donai's vowels are placed on the name, not the vowels of Wehovah. Can you see that the manuscripts themselves tell us, today we've looked at three ways in which the manuscripts tell us that the vowels on the name Shua Cholom Kametz belong to Adonai. By saying that these vowels, Shua Cholom Kametz, belong to Adonai, I'm accepting the evidence that I see in the Hebrew Bible manuscripts. Nehemiah wants you to think that if you say no, the name is not Yehovah, you're rejecting the manuscript evidence. No, I'm accepting the manuscript evidence. They tell me in many technical ways and in many different ways, they tell me that these vowels belong to Adonai. Okay, now that you understand these arguments in the normal Hebrew Bible manuscripts, you are ready for the B-52 bomber argument. You'll understand Nehemiah's argument in the B-52 bomber. And so now I'm going to show you a longer video clip of Nehemiah Gordon, where he lays out his argument clearly and plainly, and then we will look at the B-52 bomber and similar manuscripts and ask the question, is Nehemiah's argument valid? Does the B-52 bomber prove that the name is Yehovah or not?
So here's the thing. They're claiming when I see Yehovah, E-O-Ah, that that E belongs to Adonai. We just established when Adonai is preceded by the two, by La, by the word that means two in Hebrew, there's no vowel in the Aleph. So what would happen if I showed you Yehovah preceded by the Lamed? Should there be a vowel in the Yud? And the answer is obviously not, because that vowel represents the Aleph of Adonai. That's their claim. And here it is in the B-52 bomber. In this manuscript, we have La Yehovah. And not only does it have the O, which is usually missing, it has the Shva in the Yud. And you can't say that that Shva, that I of Yehovah, that that belongs to the Aleph of Adonai, because the Aleph of Adonai doesn't have a vowel in La Adonai, La Adonai. It's the vowel is dropped. So this is the B-52 bomber of manuscripts, Michael. I've discovered five manuscripts that have the same phenomenon. Five manuscripts I found where it has La Yehovah. And by the way, it's not just La Yehovah, it's Ka Yehovah, Va Yehovah, and Ba Yehovah. It's three prepositions and the word and, where that the Aleph in Adonai is silent, and so the Yud should have no vowel, and it has the vowels Yehovah. This can only belong to the name Yehovah, to the name of the Father. It can't have anything to do with Adonai. And I can't emphasize how important this is, because the opponents to this will say, but the prepositions, what about the prepositions? What about the prepositions? They show you that these are not the vowels of the name, they're the vowels of Adonai, and here it's the very prepositions that prove definitively that these are the vowels of the name of the Father alone. Boom, drop the mic. I mean, so it's over.
Okay, so again, I can understand that it looks very convincing. Nehemiah says, it's over. Is it over? Nehemiah wants you to think that the people who talk about the preposition arguments are very nervous. Oh my, the prepositions! But I'm not nervous about the preposition argument, because all these prepositions give the same answer. I don't have a problem with the preposition argument. Actually, I think Nehemiah is perhaps the one who is a bit nervous about this argument, because he knows that this is a very strong argument. Anyway, I want to sum up Nehemiah's argument for you on the screen so you can see very clearly what the argument is and what the argument is based on. In the B-52 bomber manuscript, we have Ladonai. And just as in the other good Hebrew Bible manuscripts, this vowel dropped, so here in the B-52 bomber, this vowel is dropped. There's no vowel sign underneath the Aleph of Ladonai. Okay, now look at the name. Here we have the Lamed preposition on the name, and there is a Shua underneath this Yod, where there's no Shua underneath the Aleph of Ladonai. This is the argument. It's based on the Shua. Nehemiah says, because here we have a Shua, those two dots, when Ladonai we don't have them, proves the name is Yehovah. Okay, now I'm going to give you three reasons why Nehemiah's argument is null and void. And afterwards I will explain to you why we do have a Shua there. But first of all, if the name is Yehovah, should there be a Shua underneath the Yod? Remember, this entire argument is based on the Shua there. Should there be a Shua there when we attach the Lamed preposition to the name Yehovah? The answer is no, there should have been no Shua. Look here, Yehoshaphat usually has a Shua, yes, but when you attach the Lamed preposition, the Shua drops. There should be no Shua there. It's Lehoshaphat. Yehoshua becomes Lehoshua with no vowel underneath, no vowel sign underneath that yod. Yehoram with the same vowels as we would have in Yehovah. When we attach the lamed preposition to it, we have a dot there, and that shua is dropped. So if the name was Yehovah, and we attach the lamed preposition to it, there should be no shua underneath that yod. Even in the B-52 bomber, although we don't have the name Yehoram there, we have the name Yehuda. Yehuda, Yehovah. Similar vowels, and they both begin with a yod and a shua. So usually this would be Yehuda, Judah. Now we attach the lamed preposition, that shua is dropped. In the B-52 manuscript, when we attach the lamed preposition to a name that begins with ye, there should be no shua in it, underneath that yod. Whereas here, there is a shua. If the name was Yehovah, there shouldn't be a shua there. So Nehemiah's entire argument is based on a misrepresentation of the evidence. He's misrepresenting the evidence. He should have told you, look, in Lehovah there would be no shua. No, he tells you there should be a shua if the name is Yehovah. Okay, reason number two why this argument is invalid. Even in the B-52 bomber manuscript, when the lamed preposition is attached to a name that begins with ye, what is the vowel underneath the lamed preposition? Even here in the B-52 bomber, Yehuda becomes Lehuda. You can see the dot there. It's called a chirek. There's one dot there. This is not Lahuda or La Yehuda. This is Lehuda. So if the name is Yehovah, what should we find in the B-52 bomber? We should find a dot there, Li, and there should be no vowel underneath that yod. So that vowel and that vowel tells us these vowels can't belong to the name Yehovah. Okay? Third reason. I'm going to show you now that in Hebrew, there are two reasons why the lamed preposition can be vocalized as La with a patach. Remember that stripe is called a patach. Only two reasons. Reason number one is when it's the corresponding vowel. Remember here in Adonai, that usually there's a stripe there and two dots there, and you copy that stripe over onto the lamed, corresponding vowel. The only other reason why the lamed preposition is vocalized as la with patach is when that R represents the article, the definite article. And when we have la in front of a word, and it's for reason number two, that R represents the article, we know the following word cannot be translated as a name. Let's look at an example. Here we have Jonah 4 verse 6. It reads, Me'al, Me'al le'Yonah. Now, it translates into English as above Jonah. This lamed is untranslatable in context. But if you take this out of context, le'Yonah with a lamed on Jonah, on the word Yonah there, on its own, out of context, le'Yonah means to Jonah. It's not a problem. Yonah is a proper noun here. It's someone's name, Jonah. Le'Yonah to Jonah. Okay, now remember that the lamed and the kaf take the same vowel points. So we don't have la'Yonah in the Hebrew Bible, but we do have ka'Yonah. So in the next line, we have aver ka'Yonah. That means wings like the dove. This ayir represents the article. Wings like the dove. Now, some translations, if you look at the ESV, they translate this as wings like a dove. It's a legitimate translation. The Hebrew definite article is not understood in the same way as the English definite article. But there's one thing that you cannot do here. You cannot translate Eiver ka'Yonah as wings like Jonah. You cannot. Because that R there tells you that the following word is not a name. It's not a name. Ka'Yonah or la'Yonah, in this phrase, you cannot translate Yonah as Jonah. And it's the same with La Yehovah. That La either belongs to the La of Ladonai, it's either the vowels of Adonai, or it has to represent the article and mean that Yehovah cannot be a name. Either way, you cannot translate La Yovah as to Yovah. It's like translating Kayona as like Jonah. If you do that, people will say you know nothing at all about Hebrew. You can't do that. Kayona means like the dove, not like Jonah. Okay, so that's reason number three why Nehemiah doesn't have an argument. La Yovah cannot mean to Yovah. Does Nehemiah know this? Does he know that La doesn't have anything to do with Yovah? It comes from Ladonai, or it represents the article. Either way, it doesn't work. Does he not know this? Nehemiah actually knows that this La comes from Ladonai, so he quotes Rabbi Bachrach to explain to us how this works. Now remember, who is this Rabbi Bachrach? He's the person who said, there's not a single vowel on the name Yehovah that hints at the vowels of Adonai. We looked at this in session number three. We saw that two out of the three vowels on Yehovah and Adonai are the same, and the third one does hint at it. Even if you don't know Hebrew, you can see that third vowel hints at Adonai. Okay, so this rabbi is a plain liar. He's outrightly lied to us, and yet Nehemiah uses this lie to make us think the name is Yehovah. Now here's another quote of Rabbi Bachrach. He says, the vowels of the unique name remain with it according to its own pronunciation, whereas the letters before it, which are not holy like its own letters and vowels, are vocalized and accentuated according to the pronunciation of the title Adonai. What does this mean? This rabbi is saying, we know that La is the La that R comes from Ladonai. In Ba, that R comes from Badonai, and so on. The vowel on the preposition is the vowel of Adonai. But we still hope, we blindly hope and believe that the vowels on the name are still the true vowels, even though the vowel on the prefix is the vowel of Adonai. And the argument is that the letters Yod, He, Waw, He are holy, and they cannot take dummy vowels. They have to take holy vowels. The prefix is not holy, it can take any vowel. Okay, it can take the dummy vowel. That is Rabbi Bachrach's argument, and at the end of the day, this is also Nehemiah's argument. Because he knows that La comes from Ladonai, but he still believes that the vowels next to the La belong to the name. Okay, let's test Rabbi Bachrach's argument. Let's look here in the B-52 Bomber manuscript. Abraham says, Vayomar, then he said, Adonai Yorevohe Bama Eda Ki Irashena. Adonai Yorevohe, by what or how can I know that I will inherit it? Look at the vowels on the name. What vowels are placed on the name there? Chatef Segol, a compound shua, cholem, and chirek. What happened to the holy vowels on the holy consonants yod hey waw hey? Even if the name is Yehovah, Rabbi Bachrach's argument is false, because here we have Elohim's vowels on the name. So what is the truth? Do the vowels of the unique name remain with it according to its own pronunciation, or are they replaced with the vowels of the title that is to be pronounced? I mean, look at the manuscript. The true vowels, whatever it is replaced with the vowels of Elohim. Rabbi Bachrach's argument is a plain lie. You don't need to look far to find this out. Genesis 15. Okay? Why does Nehemiah use this lie? Did he never check? Does he not know that this is a false argument? Why? Actually, I think it's scary that a scholar should use lies to prove his point. I don't think it's a good idea. Okay, now that you've seen that Nehemiah doesn't have an argument that there should be no shua there if the name is Yehovah, that there should not be a stripe there if the name is Yehovah, now that you understand that this argument was misrepresented, now I want to explain to you why there is a shua there where we have no shua in Ladonai. Now I can explain this to you from a grammatical perspective, but that's not good enough. I want to show you real evidence. Real evidence that will answer the question, does that shua make the name Yehovah or not? I want to see real evidence. So there's one place in the Hebrew Bible where we can do this test. It's Psalm 68, where we have the lamed preposition attached to the name, Yod-Heh, and it's also pronounced as Elohim. So it's pronounced as Le-Elohim. And then we can see there, did the scribes also insert an extra shwa there with Elohim's vowels or not? Okay, so let's look at an example. That the problem is that in the B-52 bomber, that phrase doesn't occur. So we can't test the argument in the B-52 bomber. However, there are other similar manuscripts. So here's a manuscript that Nehemiah referenced somewhere, where we have the lamed preposition on the name, and there is a shwa underneath the yod, where in Ladonai there is no vowel. So in this manuscript, Ladonai is spelled with a kamatz, not a patach. It's just an alternative spelling. Still, there's no vowel there, and here we have a vowel sign. Nehemiah says that this vowel sign, that shwa there, proves the name is Yehovah. In this manuscript, we can test the argument in Psalm 68. Let's look at this. And I'm going to apply Nehemiah's argumentation here, and you tell me whether it works or not. Here we have, in this manuscript, where Le Yehovi, in Le Elohim, there's no vowel on the Aleph. Here in Le Yehovi, there is a vowel underneath the Yod. This proves definitively that these are the vowels of the name of the Father, not the vowels of Le Elohim, because in Le Elohim there's no vowel on the Aleph. This can only belong to the name Yehovah, to the name of the Father. It can't have anything to do with Le Elohim, because here is a Shua and there is no Shua. That is Nehemiah's argument, tested with the vowels of Elohim. So, either the name is Yehovah and Yehovah at the same time in the same manuscript, or these are the vowels of Elohim and Adonai. Now I want to explain to you from a grammatical perspective why we have a shwa here underneath the yod here, where on the aleph we don't have a shwa. And it's a little bit complicated, but it's the difference between an aleph and a yod in the Hebrew Bible. The general rule is this: in the middle of a word, every consonant must have a vowel sign attached to it. Even when that consonant has no vowel in pronunciation, you use a certain vowel sign to indicate that there is no vowel to be pronounced with that consonant. The exception is the aleph. Look here, in Ladonai, that aleph has no vowel sign attached to it. Now, how do they indicate a silent aleph, an aleph without any vowel? They indicate this using the stripe called rafe above the aleph. That is the sign that tells you there is no vowel on the aleph. That sign there tells you the aleph is silent, it has no vowel. The same in Le Elohim, that aleph has no vowel. How do you indicate this on an aleph? You put a stripe above it, that tells you the aleph has no vowel. A yod is different. A yod is different. So, a yod can form part of a vowel, as in Leilot, nights, and also as in Li Horam. Here the yod is part of the vowel Tzere. This is called a Tzere yod. A Tzere yod. It's a A sound. That yod is part of the vowel, therefore it doesn't need a vowel sign. Okay? Here we have Chayai, my life. That yod is at the end of a word. It doesn't need a vowel sign. But here we have Walayla. Walayla means and night. Now, that yod there in pronunciation has no vowel. Layla. Layla. There's no vowel with that yod. No vowel is pronounced with that yod. And how do we indicate this? We use a silent shwa. That silent shwa tells you that there is no vowel on the yod. It's a vowel pointing, it's a vowel sign, but that shwa is not really a vowel. It's a silent shwa. It tells you there's no vowel on the yod. So this is the difference between the aleph and the yod. On an aleph, you place a stripe above it to tell that there is no vowel on that consonant. With a yod, you place two dots beneath it to indicate that there is no vowel to be pronounced with that yod. Placing a stripe above the yod will not do the job. If you place a stripe above the yod, it indicates sometimes that there is no doubling dagish in the yod. If you want to indicate on a yod no vowel, you use a silent schwa, those two dots. So what happened here with the vowels of Elohim? We have Leilohim. We put Leilohim's vowels on the name. That Tzere goes there, the Cholam goes there, the Cherek goes there. And now we have a problem. Because on Leilohim, we placed a stripe above it to indicate the Aleph is silent and it has no vowel. And now we can't place a stripe on the Yod to indicate that there's no vowel. So how do we deal with this? So different scribes had a different training, different backgrounds, and they had different techniques of pointing. So we saw that in all the important Hebrew Bible manuscripts, the scribes decided we're leaving that yod without any vowel sign, but then it looks artificial. You can just see by looking at it, if there's no vowel sign on the yod, you know it's artificial. It looks artificial because we've got artificial vowels in the name. Now these scribes decided we don't like the yod standing without a vowel sign. We need to indicate using a vowel sign the silent aleph of Leilohim. How do you indicate a no vowel on a yod? Simple shua. So they are indicating the silent aleph of Leilohim using a silent shua underneath the yod. That is not a vowel. It's a vowel sign, a vowel pointing, it's silent shua, it's not a vowel, it's a no vowel sign, oftentimes. So this represents the silent aleph of Leilohim. The same thing happened with Adonai's vowels. We have Ladonai, we put the kamets on the lamed, and the cholam there above the hay, and that kamets goes on the wow, and now we have a yod here. What do we do with the yod? These scribes didn't like a yod standing without a vowel sign, so they indicated for us that there's no vowel to be pronounced there. Remember that yod represents basically the aleph of Ladonai. How do you indicate on a yod that there's no vowel? You use a simple shua. You can see the scribes use the same system here with Ladonai's vowels and with Leilohim's vowels. This shua here does not make the name Yehovah. So also it cannot make the name Yehovah. So even if you don't understand the aleph and the yod, you can see here that the shua does not make the name Yehovah. Let's look at another example. This is a manuscript from the Russian National Library where the B-52 bomber is also kept. Now, to find a manuscript that has the Shua next to the Lamed preposition and also includes Psalm 68 verse 21 is very rare. Most manuscripts that have the Shua next to the Lamed preposition on the name are manuscripts of the Torah. Many others are fragments. There are very few of these manuscripts that actually include Psalm 68. But here is another one. Nehemiah says that shua there where Ladonai has no shua proves the name is Yehovah and these cannot be the vowels of Adonai. In this manuscript we can test it with Elohim's vowels. Here we have the name where it's pronounced as Leilohim. So here we have a segol, that's also an alternative vowel to tzere, very similar, like the kamets and the patach, we have a segol and the tzere. So this is Leilohim's vowels, but we have a shua underneath the yod where Leilohim has no shua. Nehemiah's argument says that shua proves these vowels, the vowels here on the name Yehovah, can't have anything to do with Elohim. Is that a good argument? Is that true? No, it's not true. The scribes are indicating the silent aleph of Leilohim using a simple shua. That vowel represents, that vowel sign represents the silent aleph of Leilohim and the silent aleph of Ladonai. So now you can see Nehemiah's argument is not only misrepresented, but it doesn't work when we test it with Elohim's vowels. Nehemiah Gordon is still pushing this argument of the B-52 bomber. He's still misrepresenting the evidence. Let's look at another video of Nehemiah Gordon, a more recent one, where he talks about this B-52 bomber manuscript and the preposition argument.
And in Luke, we just read the verse in Luke, and there it says, and to prepare for Yehovah, or to Yehovah the people, and it's La Yehovah with the full vowels. In Adonai, that first letter should have no vowel, but the fact that it has La Yehovah in the B-52 Bomber Hebrew manuscript, now in over 150 manuscripts of the Old Testament, we know it has this exact same thing. And it's even in the Gospel of Luke in Hebrew, proving definitively from a linguistic perspective that these are the true vowels of the name itself, not the vowels of Adonai, even in the Hebrew Gospel of Luke from the Vatican.
Amen. Amen.
Okay, so can you see Nehemiah is still misrepresenting this same argument? Let's look at this very manuscript. Nehemiah reads this as La Yehovah. I've explained to you, you can't read this as La Yehovah and translate it as to Yehovah. If the name was Yehovah, there would have been a chirek there and no vowel sign underneath the yod, because the yod forms part of the vowel chirek, and we would have Lehovah. Nehemiah Gordon has never shown any manuscript that reads Lehovah. We do not know of any Hebrew Bible manuscript in the world that points the name as Lehovah. Now that would immediately tell us that the scribe who wrote the manuscript believed the name was Yehovah. But there is no such manuscript that we know of, nor is there such a manuscript that Nehemiah knows of. So he has to work with manuscripts like this and misrepresent the evidence to make us think the name is Yehovah. Remember, when we have a name that begins with Yeh and we attach the Lamed, the Shua drops away. We have Lehoshaphat. Yehoshua becomes Lehoshua. Yehoram becomes Lehoram. If the name is Yehovah, we would find manuscripts that read Lehovah. We don't. We don't find any such manuscripts. Now, does that Shua prove the name is Yehovah? Let's look at two more manuscripts in which we can test the argument. This is a manuscript from the National Library of France, and usually next to the Lamed preposition on the name, the Shua is there, where Ladonai does not have a Shua. Here we have Havu, and then the Lamed preposition on Yodewah Hei, give to Yodewah Hei, and we have a Shua underneath the Yod. Does that Shua prove the name is Yehovah? That's the question, and we can answer the question just by looking at Psalm 68, verse 21. So I'm going to use Nehemiah's argument here, and here in this manuscript we can see where Le Yehovi with the full vowels in Le Elohim, that Aleph is silent and the Yod should have no vowel, but the fact that it has the Shua here in Le Yehovi proves definitively from a linguistic perspective that these are the vowels of the name Yehovi, not the vowels of Elohim. That is Nehemiah's argument, tested with the vowels of Elohim. It doesn't work. At the end of the day, that Shua does not make a difference to the argument, because all it does is it represents the Aleph of Le Elohim, or the Aleph of Ladonai. One last example, and this is the Russian National Library, EVR 2 B808. So this is the 808 bomber of Hebrew Bible manuscripts. Here we have the Lamed preposition attached to the name. There's a Shua underneath the Yod there where Ladonai has no Shua. That is supposed to prove the name is Yehovah. We can test it in this manuscript where we have the Lamed preposition attached to the name with Elohim's vowels. Here we have a Shua underneath the Yod of Yodewah Hei with Elohim's vowels. There you can see the Cholim and the Chirek. These are Elohim's vowels placed on the name, and the scribe inserted a Shua there where Le Elohim does not have a Shua. Does this prove definitively that the name is Yehovi, or does this make no difference to the argument? The Shua there makes no difference to the argument. The argument is not really about the Shua. Some scribes insert the Shua to represent the silent Aleph of Le'elohim and Adonai, others did not. That's not the argument. The argument is about the vowel on the preposition. In the B-52 bomber, what do the prepositions tell us? In the B-52 bomber, remember, that Shua is not the argument. That Shua represents the silent Aleph of Badonai or of Le'elohim and so on. The argument is about that vowel underneath the bait. In the B-52 bomber, we have a stripe underneath the bait, the kaf, and the lamed prepositions. We have a stripe underneath the vowel conjunction. All this evidence tells us that the vowels of Ladonai, Badonai, Kadonai, Wadonai are placed on the name, not the vowels of Lehovah, even in the B-52 bomber and even in the Hebrew Gospel of Luke. We have a stripe underneath that lamed. So remember, even here in the B-52 bomber, Yehuda becomes Lehuda. So if the name was Yehovah, with the first vowel being a shwa, this is what we would find in the B-52 bomber, Lehovah. But we don't. We find La, Ba, Ka, and so on, that clearly tell us these vowels belong to Adonai. Okay, so here is our table. This is what we discussed today. Three clear evidences from the Masoretic text that answer the question, is the name Yehovah, or are those the vowels of Adonai? All the manuscripts agree the vowels of Adonai are usually placed on the name. Look at this center column. If the name is Yehovah, we will find Wehovah, Kehovah, Behovah, Lehovah, and we will find manuscripts that always write Yehovah Adonai, Adonai Yehovah, and never change this to the vowels of Elohim. We have never found such a manuscript. We do not know of a single such manuscript in the history of written Hebrew manuscripts. Nehemiah has never been able to find any such manuscript or present any real evidence from proving with prepositions that the name is Yehovah. This evidence does not exist. All the evidence, even in the B-52 bomber, tells us these are the vowels of Adonai. So, let's sum up. What did we learn today? We've seen today that the prepositions prove definitively. What do they prove definitively? That the vowels on the name are those of Elohim and Adonai, not the vowels of Yehovah and Yehovah. We've seen that Nehemiah's B-52 bomber argument is misrepresented because he bases his argument on that Shua, where in Lehovah there would be no Shua. His argument is inaccurate because La Yehovah doesn't mean to Yehovah. His argument is false because we tested it with Elohim's vowels and we saw that that extra Shua underneath the Yod of Yodewahe cannot make the name Yehovi or Yehovah. It's just an alternative spelling. It indicates the silent Aleph of Le'elohim or Ladonai. We've seen today that there is more evidence that the vowels of Yehovah are the vowels of Adonai than there is evidence that the vowels of Yehovah are those of Elohim. There's only one place in the Hebrew Bible where the lamed preposition is attached to the name with Elohim's vowels. Only one. There are many, many, many places where the lamed preposition is attached to the name where we see it shows Adonai's vowels and with the bait and the kaf preposition. There is much more evidence to prove that the name cannot be Yehovah than there is to prove that the name cannot be Yehovah. Nehemiah Gordon claims that in the B-52 bomber, the very prepositions prove definitively that the name is Yehovah. Did Nehemiah Gordon never check his argument? Did he never look to see what the scribes did with Elohim's vowels? Nehemiah says, this Shua in the Yod of Yodewahe next to the Lamed preposition proves that these vowels can only belong to the name of the Creator. We've looked at similar manuscripts and at Elohim's vowels, and that Shua does not prove that the vowels of Yehovah can only belong to the name of the Creator. Did Nehemiah never check his arguments? Does Nehemiah not know that next to the Lamed preposition there should be no Shua in that Yod? It should be Lehovah. Is Nehemiah ignorant, Or is he dishonest? Does he not know? Or does he not want you to know the full picture? In either way, Nehemiah's B-52 bomber argument is misrepresented. We're not finished with the B-52 bomber argument yet. Nehemiah says that this rafeh on the hay, there you can see one, and there you can see one. He says this proves definitively that these are the vowels of the name of the Creator. In the next session, this is one of the things we want to talk about, the rafeh on the hay in the B-52 bomber manuscript. In session number 7, 8 technical linguistic proofs from the Masoretic text that the vowels on the name Shua Cholom Kametz are the vowels of Adonai. In part B, we'll try to cover 5 more evidences. Today we've only looked at 3. We want to look at 5 more evidences that clearly tell us whether or not the name is Yehovah. That clearly tell us whether the vowels Shua Cholom Kametz belong to the name or whether they belong to Adonai. Until next time, Shalom and Yeshua Mashiach.